the NRA developed this strategy. It was a brilliant strategy for the NRA, and it was an absolute disaster for the country. And their strategy was to tell people, look, either you keep your guns or you let the research happen. It was a lie. It wasn't true. In fact, what we can do and what research needs to do is find those solutions that will both prevent gun violence and protect gun rights. And there are lots of things that will work. But to find out what really works, we need to do the research and test these things. There are lots of interventions, for example, universal background checks. They are designed to keep guns away from the people who shouldn't have them, but allow law-abiding gun owners to keep their guns. Things like protecting guns from access by children, safe storage, that keeps guns away from children who shouldn't have them, but does nothing to interfere with the rights of law-abiding gun owners. The same thing, taking weapons away from people convicted of domestic violence, that does nothing to interfere with the rights of law-abiding gun owners, but does take them away from people who shouldn't have them, or pursuing people who are at extreme risk to harming others with guns, or to committing suicide with guns. These are all ways that you can both protect gun rights and prevent gun violence. What we need to do is find out how best to design these things. We need to test them. We need to do the research. But what's really important to understand are two things. The Dickey Amendment doesn't prevent this research, and this research will find ways to do both.
What was the Dickey Amendment specifically? What did it say?
The Dickey Amendment was a compromise, Soledad. It was a compromise between those forces that were led by the NRA who wanted to stop this research. Not only stop the research, they wanted to destroy the whole injury center at CDC. And on the other side were those people in Congress who said, we need the research. In fact, we need more of it. And so there was a confrontation in Congress, and the NRA side was led by a congressman from Arkansas, Jay Dickey.
You ended up knowing Dickey, right? And what were the kinds of conversations that you had? Because I'd have to imagine that you butted heads, especially around this amendment.
I think butting heads, Soledad, is putting it mildly. When I first met the congressman, it was at a congressional hearing, where he asked questions of both myself and then the director of CDC, Dr. David Satcher. And it was really an ambush. It was an attack. He led the charge for the NRA, and he used quotes that were things I had never said or quotes that were taken out of context and facts and figures that were inaccurate. But it was a real confrontation, and I felt that we were mortal enemies at this hearing. Here he was, this congressman from rural Arkansas, the capital of duck hunting in America, and he was a born-again, conservative, Christian Republican. I was this curly-haired, liberal kid from the Northeast. He knew duck hunting. All I did was eat ducks. He was born again. I was born once, but we were set up for this confrontation, and it was really an attack. It was so bad that when I got back to CDC, my bosses said, hey, Rosenberg, don't you ever, ever go talk to that congressman. It would be like putting a match on gasoline. You stay away. And they said, do you understand? I mean, really, never talk to him. So what could I say but okay? But then about a month later, I got a request from his staffer to go up and review some of the data we had presented at the hearing. My bosses said, okay, you can talk to the legislative assistant, but do not talk to the congressman. So I went up, I met with a legislative staffer, we sat down, we had a really good conversation. He was interested in the data. He wanted to find out what the evidence showed. And at the end of our conversation, when I was getting up to leave, he said, oh, by the way, the congressman is in his office next door, and he'd like to say hello to you. Well, I gulped hard, and I said what I can't say on TV, but I felt, my gosh, this is really bad. Either I go and talk to him and get fired, or I refuse to talk to him and make things worse by being rude. I decided I would take the least of two evils. I went in to his office, and as I went in, I saw he had his walls covered with pictures of his kids. So I asked him questions about his kids, and we started talking about his kids. We started talking about my kids. We found out that they had some things in common, and we left on a good note. We didn't talk about guns. We didn't talk about violence or legislation. And the next thing I knew, he had invited my son and his whole class to visit and tour Congress and then to visit him in his office. It was a very nice thing that he did. I did something to help his daughter find a job in Atlanta. I did something else to help him write something. And soon we started talking and we developed a friendship. We started to trust each other. We started to like each other. And eventually we came to learn from each other. And it became a very, very close friendship. And Jay thought, part of the problem is that in the United States, we're so polarized. People don't talk to each other in Congress. Republicans don't talk to Democrats. And he said, if they could learn from our example, if we could become friends, if we could talk to each other, then anybody could. And we became very close, and we started to learn. I learned from Jay that we had to say up front in our research that we were looking to satisfy two objectives. Everything that we would pick to replicate or put into law would both reduce gun violence and protect the rights of law-abiding gun owners. That was very important to let people know that. And I think Jay learned from me in talking about how science had helped save lives in road safety. He learned that science really could get us out of this deadly morass. We talked about how research in the 1960s that was started by the government had led to safer cars and safer roads and safer drivers and had resulted in saving 350,000 lives. This was what research could do. And it did it all without banning cars. The arguments that the NRA put forward were not so dissimilar from the arguments that the automobile manufacturers put forward when safety was a big push. The automobile manufacturers said, look, if you require people to have airbags, the cars will become so expensive and cumbersome, people won't buy them. If you require people to wear seatbelts all the time, people won't want cars with seatbelts. And the automobile manufacturer said, it's either safety or sales, and you can't have both. But look what happened. Look what the research showed. The research showed that you could make cars much, much safer. You have front airbags, you have knee airbags, head airbags, you have side impact protection, front end impact protection, and seatbelts are universally required. Now, you can have both sales and safety. And in fact, from cars, we learned that safety is the biggest selling point for cars. And we not only do we not have to ban cars to make them much safer, but there are more cars on the road now than ever before in the history of the earth.